Hi Bartonella buddies, welcome back to my channel, and if you're new to my channel, my name is Jake, and today let's talk about how does Bartonella cause symptoms? Before we get into today's video, I really want to show you pictures of people wearing my merch, so I'm going to go over here to the side. Here they are. Don't they all look so cute? You know they do. You know you want to be cute too. Shameless plugging over. The symptoms of chronic manifestations of Bartonellosis are mostly due to the host response. If you're not familiar with what I mean when I say the host response, I suggest that you hit pause on this video, go watch my video on the host response, and then come back to this video. I wish I had made this video sooner, but honestly, I only just started to fully wrap my head around how Bartonella causes symptoms. I knew that Bartonellosis was due to the inflammation of blood vessels, which is called vasculitis, and I knew that it was due to the inflammation of small blood vessels specifically. I also knew that impaired blood flow caused much of the disease presentation. I also knew that the foot pain that has prevented me from being on my feet for more than 15 minutes in an entire day for over 2.5 years was due to impaired blood flow. So the next person who asks me how I healed, cue the hate comment, because I'm annoying as hell. And I knew that distal parts of the body were more vulnerable because there is more distance along the path through which blood flows for the blood flow to be impaired. And there's a lot of pressure on the feet due to weight and small surface area. So as you can imagine, more pressure means more impaired blood flow. However, beyond that, I didn't really understand it, and Googling vasculitis only got me information about vasculitis, which is a group of rare diseases like Kawasaki disease and Behçet's disease, but Bartonellosis doesn't really follow any of these patterns. It can be pretty distressing to have strange, painful, or scary symptoms and not understand why, and I don't know about you, but for me, understanding my illness is one of the very few ways I can have some semblance of control. I can't control what I will react to, I can't control when I won't be mostly bedbound anymore, but I can try to understand what's going on inside my body, and hopefully this video will help you do that too. I'm not a doctor, so I can only collate info that is available to me, so this will be a very incomplete picture of how Bartonella causes symptoms. Bartonella has been visualized outside of blood vessels and bound to collagen, but today I'm just going to focus on blood flow. Bartonella live in the endothelial cells, and these are the cells that line the blood vessels, and this is part of the reason why Bartonella causes small blood vessel disease. When a small blood vessel is inflamed, this impedes blood flow, because you can think of the passage through which the blood flows as getting smaller. And you can think of many symptoms that Bartonella causes through the idea of impaired blood flow. Blood flow is not only impaired by the smaller passageway, but it's also impaired by blood viscosity. I'm pretty sure we all learned about viscosity in high school physics. Boring. So just as a refresher, a viscous fluid has a thick, sticky consistency like honey, while water is an example of a non-viscous fluid. How does Bartonella make the blood viscous? I'm so glad I asked myself. Many infections, whether they be acute or chronic, can make the blood viscous. Even the common cold can make the blood viscous. Part of the reason the blood becomes viscous is due to the activation of platelets. And if you're wondering what exactly platelets are, don't worry, I had to look up exactly what they are too. Platelets are fragments of cytoplasm, and cytoplasm is basically everything in a cell except for the nucleus. Platelets have no cell phones. They're very antisocial. Platelets have no cell nucleus, and they respond to injury by clumping to form a clot to prevent blood loss. The medical jargon for a blood clot is called thrombus, and the formation of blood clots is called thrombosis. Don't fall asleep. Thrombosis can trap bacteria and control the spread of infection to other parts of the body. This is called directed thrombosis or immunothrombosis because the immune system is doing thrombosis to protect the rest of the body from infection. So, see, this is getting interesting. So platelets are involved in immunothrombosis, but so are neutrophils and monocytes, which are two different types of white blood cells. Platelets can bind to the surface of bacteria, while the neutrophils and monocytes facilitate blood coagulation. Another part of this inflammatory process is that white blood cells can become sticky, and that means they can stick to the blood vessel lining and crowd the passageway, so to speak. Platelet activation also stimulates fibrin formation. Fibrin is a glue-like protein that creates a mesh on top of the blood clot, and it finishes the clotting process. Fibrin has been shown to trap bacteria and prevent infection from spreading, but this also impedes blood flow by narrowing the blood vessel passage. To recap, we have Bartonella living in the lining of the blood vessels. The immune system detects an invader and responds with the process of inflammation. Platelets and white blood cells become activated and make the blood hypercoagulable, aka viscous, to sequester the invaders and protect the rest of the body from the infection. Platelet activation leads to fibrin formation to further sequester the invaders, but this narrows the blood vessel passageway and further impedes blood flow. And impaired blood flow limits the amount of oxygen and nutrients that can be delivered to a tissue. Fun fact, blood flows to every living tissue in your body, except for your cornea, which gets its oxygen and nutrients from the tear fluid on the outside of the eye and the aqueous humor, which is on the inside of the eye, and nerve fibers. The cornea does not have blood vessels because it needs to be transparent so that you can see. So since blood flows to every living tissue in your body, except for your cornea, this is why Bartonella can cause almost any symptom you can think of depending on the tissue that is being affected. Let's talk about the hallmark Bartonella foot pain. Let's talk about feet, baby. Let's talk about you and me. Not all people have this symptom, of course, but I do think it's a symptom that is more indicative of Bartonellosis specifically, as opposed to something like fatigue or joint pain. Some people can have this symptom mildly, while for others it can be completely disabling, like in my case. There are nerves and neurons. So, just kidding, a little bit more science before we get to the foot pain. Neurons are nerve cells, and a group of neurons form a nerve. So you can think of a nerve like a power cord, and the neurons are all the little wires inside that power cord. The expression, oh, that person is a bundle of nerves, is kind of funny because a bundle of neurons is a nerve, but a bundle of nerves isn't anything as far as I'm aware. The axon of a nerve is a long projection that the nerve impulses run along. Axons can be incredibly long, up to a meter, or if you're in the United States, the only place that doesn't use the metric system because we're stupid, approximately 3 feet. Fun fact, the longest axons in the human body are found in the sciatic nerve.
Ouch! Mine hurts a lot.
Long nerves have more opportunity for the blood supply to be impaired. Now we're actually going to talk about feet, baby. This is part of the reason why the feet are especially vulnerable to pain or neuropathy due to small vessel disease and Bartonellosis. Another reason for the foot pain is what is called ischemia reperfusion injury. Can you guess what we're about to do? That's right, break down the words. Ischemia refers to inadequate blood supply. It's when the supply doesn't have any friends. Inadequate blood supply. So bad. Ischemia refers to inadequate blood supply to any part of the body. So the isk part of the word means to hold back, and the emia refers to blood. Reperfusion is when the blood returns to a part of the body that's had its blood flow impaired. So perfusion refers to blood flow, and I think you can guess what the re stands for. In Dr. Moziani's Understanding Bartonella webinar, he talks about ischemia reperfusion injury, but I probably didn't look up what that meant until like the fifth time I watched it because I was like, that sounds confusing. Most of us have probably had hands and or feet get so cold to the point where they start to go numb. So not only is that painful, but what can be even more painful is when the blood starts to return. This, as far as I'm aware, is a low-grade reperfusion injury, while frostbite is an example of a more severe form. During the ischemic portion, the lack of blood flow damages tissue through lack of oxygen and nutrients. When the blood is restored during reperfusion, this causes an inflammatory process through oxidative stress. I'm going to try to make this as simple as possible. To understand oxidative stress, we first have to understand what To understand oxidative stress, we first have to understand what reactive oxygen species are. Reactive oxygen species are reactive chemical molecules that can either protect or harm tissues, just depending on the situation. In the case of oxidative stress, there is an imbalance between reactive oxygen species and the body's ability to detoxify or process the reactive oxygen species and their byproducts. So this is an inflammatory response. White blood cells respond to the damage by releasing inflammatory mediators such as interleukins and free radicals, and free radicals are a type of reactive oxygen species. During reperfusion, oxygen enters the cells, and this can damage the cells' proteins, DNA, and membrane, and that leads to further damage. Mast cells also have a role to play in ischemia reperfusion injury. They release inflammatory mediators that recruit more white blood cells to the area. And this makes sense with regard to Bartonella because mast cells reside around the microvasculature. So you can see that ischemia and reperfusion isn't just about blood flow. There's a huge immune system component to it. The immune system facilitates an inflammatory reaction. Obviously, this isn't the only mechanism through which Bartonella can cause symptoms, but in my opinion, with what we know about how much ischemia and reperfusion involves the immune system, this process alone seems like it can have a lot of downstream effects on the immune system. Anecdotally, Bartonella patients report that their foot pain is the worst in the morning. And that's how mine was when it first started, but it progressed to the point where it was bad at night as well as the morning. And then it progressed to the point where, you know, I can't walk. But my hypothesis is that the pain is in the morning because the pain is delayed due to reperfusion. You're on your feet all day with a lot of pressure on the microvasculature in the feet that feed the nerves, and you don't necessarily feel the low-grade lack of blood flow. But what you do feel is pain in the morning from reperfusion after relieving that pressure while sleeping through the night. You can compare this process to diabetic foot ulcers or pressure wounds, both of which are thought to be mediated by ischemia and reperfusion. It is thought that the continuous pressure limits blood flow, and when the blood flow is restored, that causes inflammation. So the continuous cycle of ischemia and reperfusion leads to tissue damage, and that results in the pressure sores or the diabetic foot ulcers. Bartonella buddies, I always worry after I'm filming, I'm like, oh my god, was that video entertaining enough? I am 87 pounds, so it's hard to have energy. And when I'm tired, my jokes are even worse than they normally are, but that's what the editing process is for. But to be fair, I make bad jokes when I'm not tired. In my interview with Amy and Jack, Amy talks about Jack's brain fog being due to hypoperfusion. So we already know what perfusion means, and the hypo means low, so I'm pretty sure you can guess what hypoperfusion means. Jack's brain fog, and almost everyone who has brain fog due to Bartonellosis, is due, at least in part, to reduced blood flow and lack of oxygen and nutrients, which makes it very hard to think clearly. So now let's briefly talk about the cognitive and neuropsychiatric symptoms that are associated with Bartonellosis. In Dr. Moziani's webinar, he talks about how Bartonellosis can cause almost any neuropsychiatric or cognitive symptom you can think of. The symptoms of the central nervous system are often some of the first symptoms seen because the white matter of the brain have bad collateral flow. The gray matter in the brain has good collateral flow. You can think of it as a place that has many different roads to the same place. The white matter, on the other hand, doesn't have good collateral flow, so you can think of it as an area that has only one road in and one road out, and so that makes it susceptible to symptoms from small blood vessel inflammation. This doesn't mean that the gray matters of the brain aren't affected, however, because the white matter and the gray matter are highly interconnected. I'm not going to go any deeper into this topic because Dr. Moziani covers it very well in his webinar, so I'll leave a timestamp right here. So you can go to this timestamp to watch that part of the webinar. These are my magic tricks. I can make things appear and disappear. The best way to support my channel and my hard work is by hitting the like button on this video, hitting that subscribe button if you haven't already, and shopping my Bartonella Babe merch if you so choose. And here are my social media handles to stay most up to date with my health journey. You want to see a magic trick? Now you see her, now you don't. Now you see her again. Bye, Bartonella buddies!